Good afternoon, everybody. Could you please close the door in the back? And I would like to welcome you all here to our next series of MENDEL lectures, 2015-2016. My name is Martin Anger. I'm speaking on behalf of Lumiere Greci and other organizers of this series of scientific events. And I was told to remind you that MENDEL lectures has a new web page and new design of the web page, so you could check the coming events. And today I'm honored and glad that I can welcome here Professor Masaru Okabe from Osaka University. And it's a great opportunity to hear, achievements from a great scientist who made remarkable and breakthrough discoveries in the field of reproductive biology. Professor Okabe was mostly active in the field of transgenesis of animals, transgenic mice, and he also, made really important discoveries which advanced knowledge in the field of the talk between the sperm and the egg during the fertilization. And with his colleagues, they identified key molecules involved in this, negotiation of the new life. I would like to give floor to Professor Okabe, invite him to give a lecture.
Thank you, Martin and Lumiere, for inviting, and other organized members for inviting me here. And it is my big pleasure or big honor to have a chance to give a talk in this memorial place, and I'm very much honored. Thank you very much. And I have 1 hour to go, so I start quickly. And today I like to talk about, the green mice and the mechanism of fertilization today. And if you mix the sperm and the egg in the sea urchin, the egg jelly coat activates sperm and fertilization take place very easily. But when you do this in the mouse, this is a mouse sperm and equally very motile, but if you mix with the eggs, they do not fertilized eggs in the past. And the reason is, of course, the fertilization takes place in mammals in the female reproductive tract, so it's not so easy like a seawater. It's very different. So initially, it was not successful for many years. But in 1971, the professor Toyoda found out a good medium for the in vitro fertilization in the mouse. And if we use this medium, we could succeed to fertilize eggs like this is a fertilization rate, and sperm can penetrate the eggs like this. But as you can see, there's a gap, a time lapse from addition of the sperm to the entry of the sperm into the egg. So this time is called capacitation. So this is a big difference in the sea urchin sperm and the mammalian sperm. The mammalian sperm has to have some time to spend in the female reproductive tract, or even in the in vitro, the sperm has to spend some time to change themselves. And many research were done. What is capacitation and acrosome reaction in mammalian sperm? And many factors were postulated in the past. And 2007, the Nobel Prize was given these three guys, and it was the gene knockout. It is that was the Nobel Prize matters. And since gene knockout became very available in this field, we knock out many genes one by one. And the first one was the acrosin knockout. And if you knock out acrosin, it's supposed to be a very important factor in fertilization, but nothing happened. And then galactase was knocked out, and nothing happened. And then SED1 was knocked out, and nothing happened. So these factors were considered to be a very important factor in vitro fertilization system. They used the antibody, they used the ligands and something like that. But the actual gene knockout did not make any difference in the real mouse. And PH20, which is a hyaluronidase, knocked out, nothing. C3B, nothing. And CRISP1, nothing happened. And zonaldohexin, nothing happened. CD46, nothing. PKD-reg, nothing. SP56, fertilin, so nothing. So the history of the gene knockout in the reproduction field, you never have a expected result for many, many genes. So even if the remaining factors are here, but you never know if this is really important or not, because after we found out so many genes should be important or not important in gene knockout systems. So we have to, start from the scratch. And from this slide, I lost many of my friends. And they say the reason we have no phenotype is that our bodies, like factors, mix up very closely each other. So if you knock out one gene, it may give a hole here. And there's no such a animal or the living thing here. If you knock out something, that part has to be compensated by other factors. So that's why they say that we cannot find a good phenotype. And also, the fertilization is such an important process in the living things. So those system has to be doubly secured to, even if one gene has gone, others can help. That is the our bodies made like that. That was their idea. But it was denied by calmagin knockout. The calmagin is a testis-specific antigen, and which is a molecular chaperone, turned out to be a molecular chaperone, and expressed only in the testis. And calmagin and calnexin are very similar. Both of them are molecular chaperone, and calnexin is everywhere in the body, but the calmagin is only in the testicular cells. So we knock out calmagin knockout mice, expecting something happens in the spermatogenesis. And the result, we found no phenotype. The sperm was made very nicely, and nothing happened. So we are working at the core facility of Osaka University of gene-manipulated animals. So we made many gene knockout mice for other people. And at the moment, we knocked out about 300 genes. And the result of those 300 gene knockout, we have about 20%, 30% of the phenotype. And the 70% of the gene knockout shows not a very clear phenotype. That was our experience. So when I met Alan Bradley, and he is also make a lot of gene knockout in the EUCOM systems, and I told him, I think 70% of the gene knockout doesn't make any good phenotype. And he said, 70, he said 60. So he and I share about the same similar idea, that about 60% of the gene knockout makes no very clear phenotype. So we don't have to be very surprised by the result of this many gene knockout did not give us any clear phenotype. So we think, I like to show that the power law, there's a called law, power law, and this is about the earthquake or the craters on the moon. So we have earthquakes, but the big ones numbers, very small numbers. But the small earthquakes are so many. And like a crater on the moon, big one are some, but the small one are so many. So this is called power law. And this, I don't know which one is first, but the Italian economist back in 1896, he said Pareto's principle. And he said 20% of the money are shared by the 80% of the people. And 80% of the money is shared by 20% of the people. So the money goes in different manners. So I think power law and also this Pareto's principle is very similar. And functions of the genes are equally applicable of these things. So many people think that we have many genes, but each of them have each own very important roles. But if we apply this theory, the some genes, like 80% of the genes have very minor roles, and 20% of the genes have 80% of our functions. I think that's what we found out after the 300 gene knockout. That is what I really believe. And back in 2012, I think, 2012, in the Nature, there was a column showing that they said here, many landmark findings in preclinical oncology research are not reproducible. This is submitted by the Amgen, the company Amgen. And also the same thing was done said by the Behringer company, pharmaceutical companies. So many papers, which should be very important prestigious journals papers, are not reproducible, many of them. And there are some such a complaining. And 2014, the science editor said, yes, okay. Science also has some complaining from those people. So she said, okay, from now on, science will make the regulation more strict, like double-blind test or the increase the number of animals and statistics has to be applied more strict ways. And that is what is written in 2014. But I don't think that will solve the problem of 90% of ill reproducibility in the science. Because I think what I believe is that since 70% of the genes, which was supposed to be important in the past experiment, was by the knockout, they show no phenotype. So this relate to this 90% of no reproducibility in the experiment. That is my understanding. And also, we have to say the prediction of the gene function. If we say this gene has to be very important in certain such a phenomenon, like calmagene. Calmagene is expressed in the germline cells. So it should have only in germline cells. So it should have a role in the spermatogenesis. But nothing happened. But luckily, we found out that calmagene knockout males were infertile. And the phenotype was the sperm, if you knock out the sperm, calmagene, the sperm does not bind to the zona. And this is the wild type, and the sperm doesn't bind to the zona. So it becomes infertile. So if you do the gene knockout, it's like a basketball, and the goal is spermatogenesis, and you make a shoot, but it didn't go into the goal, but goes into the next court, next goal, and the fertilization. So 80% of our knowledge covers only 20% of the truth. That if I apply the Pareto's rule here. So many experiments tells us something, but that's only part of the truth. That is what I think. And in case of CD9 knockout, CD9 is a famous protein on the membrane. And in the Wikipedia, it also, even today, it is described that it is signal transduction events. It's involved in there. So if you knock out the CD9, this was done by the immunology people, and they thought there's some phenotype in immunology. But they found out the CD9 knockout mice are healthy, live normally. But they found out the mice were sterile. So they brought the mice to us, and we checked what happened. And in this case, the females of the female mice become infertile. And the reason was that the sperm cannot fuse with the eggs. So usually, so the blue color here is the sperm. Usually, you have only one sperm per one egg. But here, you have many, many sperm. And the reason is, in case of calmagene knockout, sperm cannot bind to the zona and no fertilization. But in case of CD9 knockout, sperm cannot fuse with the eggs. So usually, if the fusion takes place, there's a mechanism of polyspermy block, and second sperm cannot come into the zona. But since the fusion does not take place, the next sperm comes in next by next, and then it becomes very full of sperm. And this is what happened in the CD9 knockout. So we cannot predict the role of the gene very easily. That is also very true, I think. And before I proceed more about the mechanism of fertilization, I like to talk about the green mouse. And in the 2008, these three persons got, including Shimomura, Dr. Shimomura, got the Nobel Prize for the GFP. And my mentor and Dr. Shimomura knew each other. And my five-year senior student did the postdoc in his lab. And he told me that a great percent of his time was spent to catching jellyfish. And he told me there is a protein which glows in the dark. And I knew this a long time ago. But 15 years later, I was searching for the vital marker for to mark the sperm. I was searching for the good markers, but I could not remember my five-year senior person's story at all. So, but after I find out the GFP is applicable in the C. elegans, and I received the gene from them and get the mouse in the made a green mouse in the, for the first time. So if I remember my senior person's story before reading the paper, the second paper, the Chalfi, he did the first GFP users. But if I remember my five-year senior person's story, the second picture could have been another picture. And Roger Tsen, he made a mutant of the GFP. So the first GFP mouse, green mouse, was green, but not so greatly green. But after he found out enhanced the type of GFP, the mouse became very, very green. And we made about 100, more than 100 lines of green mice. And the reason we made such many green mice is we wanted to have them on the X and Y chromosomes. If we have the GFP on the sex chromosome, we can do something like this. So in case of X GFP and Y, if this we use this mouse, male mice, this mouse will produce X GFP sperm and Y non-GFP sperm, two kinds of sperm. And if the X sperm fertilizes eggs, that makes a female, and it's a green. And if it's a male sperm, Y sperm, it makes male, but no non-green. So this is the blastocyst stage of mouse embryos, and no one can tell which one is a male and which one is a female embryos. But if we use this mice, then we can tell which one is a female and which one is a male very easily. So using this mouse, I ask Ayako Isotani to make sex chimera. And when they are the eight cell stage, something missing here, but the eight cell stage embryos, while they are eight cells, if you mix them together, they make one embryo. So this makes the sex chimera. Male and female cells makes one individual body. And we made about 1,700, so many sex chimeras. And among 1,700, male was 1,200, and female was 500. So somewhat it distorted to the male, a little bit more males. But basically, they become male or females. Very few chances of getting the hermaphroditis. So what happens in the female cells in testes? That is what we wanted to know. And since this sex chimera is made with a green female and a non-green male, if you see the testes, this is a section of the testes. The green part is a contribution, shows the contribution of female cells. And non-green part is the male cells. And TL898 is the germ cell-specific antigen. So if you stain with this, here's the GFP positive and TL898 positive. This means inside the testes, female cells are developing as a spermatogonia. Even if the cell is female, it can become a spermatogonia. But are they really a spermatogonia? We checked. And if it's a spermatogonia, the testes have testicular germ cells have its testis specific imprinting. And if it's a female, it has a female specific imprint. So we collected those green cells from the testes and check if they are female type imprint or male type imprint. And the result is the male type imprint. So if you mix the male and female cells together and make a testis, the female cells become really like a spermatogonia. And even the imprint is a spermatogonia. That was very surprising to us. But then can we make a female sperm? from the female cells, can we make sperm? The answer is no. After 4 or 5 days, those germ cells die out. And after 35 days, all the green germ cells disappears. And yeah, some green are remaining here, but these are Sertoli cells, not the germ cells. But we also found another interesting things, which is the very big green spot here and there. And if I take out the seminiferous tubules, and inside the seminiferous tubule, we see a very big cells, which is look like an egg. And we egg is covered by the zona pellucida, so we stain the zona pellucida by the antibody. Sorry, this part is somewhat missing. And these testicular eggs were stained by the anti-zona pellucida, and they were positive. Maybe it's probably computer stuff. And this means inside the testis, eggs can develop inside the testis in the seminiferous tubule. And also, we checked if the eggs, testicular eggs, can have a fusing ability with sperm. And if this is a blue, that means sperm fused with the eggs. So these eggs, testicular egg, has a fusing ability with sperm. So that was also very surprising to us. So female cells can undergo a male-type imprinting, but they die out. But if they survive, if they develop as an egg inside the male seminiferous tubules, then they survive and develop to the egg, the real egg. That was the green sperm part. And go back to the sperm-egg interactions. After calmagene knockout, we made another gene knockout, which is a calreticulin, which is also the sperm testis-specific molecular chaperone. And Ikawa-san knocked out this one, and we found out this is also infertile. So in the earlier, I showed many slides that are saying this is not important. But after that, whatever we knock out, the phenotype becomes the same. The sperm zona interaction is interrupted. So CalRAL3 is the same way, and we knock out the PDILT knockout mouse, which is a disulfoidal isomerase, which is also contribute to fold the proteins. And this is also the mice become infertile. And other group also made a red one is our group, and the blue one is other. Red one is ours, and the blue one is others. And many were published, but many of them are equally the gene name is written here, but it's not appeared here. But many genes share the same phenotype of zona binding is not going well. And among those calmagene, CalRAL3, and something like that, all of them share the same phenotype, which is ADAM3 is lacking from the sperm. ADAM3 knockout is also infertile. But whatever you knock out, ADAM3 disappears from the sperm. So probably ADAM3 is the responsible factor for the sperm zona binding. And I show you what happens in the zona binding. And this is the wild-type sperm with the zone, with the eggs, and the sperm bind to the zona. And so many sperm bind, so the eggs start to move around. But in case of a knockout, of, this is a case of a PDILT, but whatever you bring the knockout of that tables, they become, they bounce back from the zona. They come to the zona, but they are bounced back, and no binding to the zona. But we thought Adam 3 might be very much responsible for this phenomena, but Adam 3 cannot be detectable in this. We can detect it by Western blotting, but not this silver staining. You never can see the spot. So we thought the volume, the amount of Adam 3 must be very small. So it cannot be handled. Those very vigorously swimming sperm can just once it comes to the zona, it stick there. So the very small amount of Adam 3 may not function with this. So there should be another factors involved in the sperm zona binding. So we checked the calmagine knockout and calreticulin knockout one and compared to the wild type in the 2D gels. And we found out one here. This is we call it a PMIS2, but it's missing in this these two knockout. So this is the amount can be okay for the probably responsible for the sperm zona binding. So we knock out this gene, and I hope this is okay. We expected that if we knock out this gene, Adam 3 stays like there, but only this PMIS2 is missing from the sperm. Then the story is finished, that PMIS2 is the ultimate sperm zona binding factor. But unfortunately, if you knock out PMIS2, the Adam 3 disappears. And if you knock out Adam 3, PMIS2 disappears. So we never know which one is more important at this moment. And common phenotype in various genes, but here it says angiotensin converting enzyme. And angiotensin converting, others are all membrane proteins, but angiotensin converting enzyme is an enzyme. So one of my colleagues published a paper that the angiotensin converting enzyme has a glycosyl phosphatidyl inositol GPI anchor protein cutting activities. So usually enzyme has only one activities, but this ACE may have two enzymatic activities, which does not relate to the first enzyme and the second enzyme. So we published this paper, but it was another group like angiotensin converting enzyme is a very famous enzyme, so very many researchers there, and they said they cannot reproduce the result. So we are very much in a bad condition. We say yes, but they say no. And since I said other people's factors are not important, because not essential, many people studied about Adam 3 for many years, and Adam 3 knockout, Adam 3 is not, Adam 2 for many years, but Adam 2 was not important in fertilization. So this time, the others going to accuse me of my reproducibility of our research. And this was solved without just by luck. And we made a TEX-101 knockout mouse line. TEX-101 is a GPI anchor protein. And if we knock out the TEX-1, then the sperm, the male becomes infertile. And we found out that TEX-101 is associating with ADAM3 in testes. And after it comes out to the epididymis, which is the storage place for the sperm, the TEX-1 disappears, but ADAM3 become a mature type. And ADAM3, so the TEX-101 is probably helping folding the ADAM3 in a proper position. But if you knock out the TEX101, the ADAM3 is not properly folded and does not come out to the sperm surface. That was found out. And since the TEX101 is a GPI anchor protein, we checked with the ACE knockout. So in the ACE knockout, in the wild type, TEX101 hasn't disappeared probably by ACE. But if you knock out ACE, then TEX101 cannot be removed from the sperm. And this makes the ADAM3's positioning on the sperm surface in wrong places. So it was found out that the real substrate for the ACE was the TEX101. So we said the ACE knockout, ACE is a double enzymatic activities, but the other one, the GPI ACE, GPI anchor ACE was the substrate was not the real one. So if you use the TEX101 as a substrate, the difference was so clear. So we find out that the ACE is really a GPI ACE. Now the ADAM3 is the king of the essentials. Whatever you knock out ADAM3, it turned out to be the ADAM3 deficiencies. So if we tell the ADAM3 is the real one or not, in a mouse, rat, dog, cow, and monkey, every animal has the ADAM3. So ADAM3 might be the real factors, important factors. But in human, the ADAM3 is a pseudo gene. So you cannot apply this theory to the human. But probably the human must be the exception, but the basic mechanism stays under the under this must be the equal. That is what we are expecting. So it was recently found out that we knock out L6K knockout. Everything comes from the knockout. We do the knockout first, and then we make an antibody. If we find a phenotype, we then make an antibody. So we make a lot of knockouts, and L6K is also a GPI anchor protein, and we made a knockout of this. And this L6K was initially published by other group that it may associate with TEX101. So what happens in the L6K knockout? So we did the knockout. And I asked Fujihara-san to knock out this gene. And as we expected, if we knock out this, the male becomes infertile. So this association in the testis, TEX101, ADAM3, and LY6K in the testis is very important for the ADAM3 to be expressed on the sperm surface. But even in the wild type, the sperm has no LY6K. So LY6K cannot be the real factor for the sperm zone binding. So what we need to think about is there's another factor. The true factor is here, something X. And the real factor must be here. And if you knock out the TEX101, if you knock the TEX101, then the ADAM3 is not properly folded and doesn't come up to the sperm surface. But the LY6K knockout, TEX101 does not affect it. So ADAM3 is properly folded and it comes out to the sperm surface. So this is the first case that the ADAM3 come out to the sperm surface and become infertile. So, but LY6K does not stay on the sperm surface. So there should be another factor on the sperm. And we have a candidate factor for X by knockout experiment, but it will be published in not too long. And common phenotype in various gene-disrupted mouse lines, and I said zona binding is bad in many of these, but amazingly, these genes have a similar, I mean, equally common phenotype, oviduct migration impairment. So sperm does not bind to the zona, but also the sperm does not migrate into the oviduct. One is only the exception is ADAM3, but we thought we are not believing in this, so we received the mice from them and did our by ourselves, and actually the ADAM3 knockout also sperm does not migrate into the oviduct. So we thought the calmagene knockout sperm is become infertile because sperm does not bind to the zona. And I think everybody in this room will agree this idea, but it was wrong. If you, so the sperm does not migrate into the oviduct. So what happens to take these sperm into the directory to the ampullar part of the oviduct to bypass this part? And what will happen? If the point is the sperm cannot bind to the zona, these sperm are also not possible to fertilize eggs. But by doing this, the sperm can fertilize eggs. So our assumption that the zona binding is the main cause of the infertility was wrong. So something we think this should be very correct is fail. So that was my experience was this factor is very important, but the knockout, nothing happens. And if this phenotype of the knockout must be originated from this phenotype, but actually it's not. So everything is so unpredictable. And since we make our green mice, but green mice was not produced green sperm because initially the GFP was made to produce inside the cytosol, but sperm has very few amount of cytosol, so sperm is not green at all. So we made another construct to make the GFP targeted inside the acrosol here, and we can get the green sperm. And we ask Tomoko Nakanishi to make aggregation again. The calmagene knockout make it green, and the wild type mouse, and we make a chimera. And this mouse has two types of sperm, exactly two types of sperm, which is a normal type sperm and the calmagene knockout sperm. And in this chimera, if we mate them, the uterus is mixture of a knockout and a non-knockout. So we were wondering if the wild type sperm has sends some signal to here, then every sperm can go up, like a open sesame type of things, and then all the sperm can go up. But if each sperm has a ticket, then only the wild type sperm can pass through the gate. And the result was that if you see the calmagene knockout can penetrate to the oviduct, you have to see the green thing here, but we could not. So the this result indicate that the mechanism of sperm penetrating into the oviduct is this system, not by all the sperm goes into without open the gate system. No, it's like a ticket system. The sperm has their own ticket to migrate into the oviduct. And the next one is the sperm-egg fusion protein. We call it the ESM1. And sperm has does not have a fertilizing ability when ejaculated, but they have to have a change called the acrosome reaction, which the acrosome disappears from the sperm head, and then these sperm can bind and fuse to the eggs. So we said, we thought if we have a nice antibody which bind to here, only to this sperm, and block sperm egg fusion, we can find out the fusion proteins. And we made one of the monoclonal antibodies which bind to the acrosome reacted sperm only, and also the blocks the fusion. But for a long time, we cannot figure out the antigen for a long time. But recently, the ECL system get better, and we find out that this can be detectable. So we did the LC-MS-MS experiment and found out that this antigen must be something like this. And it has a simple peptide and a signal, a simple peptide like this, and one signal peptide and IG domain, one IG domain, and a transmembrane type. So something like this. And since we know the antigen, we did a knockout. And at that time, we called this OBF13 gene, but we made a knockout. And whatever, before, any factors we made a knockout was all failed. So we are very much scared if the OBF13 knockout can effectively work out or not. But the very lucky OBF13 the male become infertile. And this is a mixture of wild-type sperm and eggs. And this is a mixture of the OBF13 knockout with eggs. So many sperm are still trying to penetrate the zona of the eggs, because there's no eggs are not fertilized. So the sperm thinks the eggs are still infertile, can tell they're infertile. So they're still attacking the eggs. So the difference was so clear. So ESMO, we call this one ESMO now. So ESMO knockout mice are completely infertile. They never make a pup. And ESMO was, for a long time, we know, in spite of very many experiments, fusion was not solved at all for many, many years. But the ESMO was the first one which was shown to involve in the sperm egg fusion. But only ESMO was known, and CD9 was known, but ESMO and CD9 does not relate each other. So ESMO was a sort of an orphan receptor. But recently, the British people find out that the Juno is the binding to the ESMO, and also knockout of Juno makes an egg to be not fertilizable with sperm. So we just know two factors interacting each others. So this is the beginning of the sperm egg fusion mechanism experiment. And the last part of my talk is about the live imaging. And how does ESMO behave during fertilization process? The ESMO is not appeared on the sperm surface, but only after acrosome reaction that appears on the sperm surface. But acrosome reaction means this part of the membrane disappears, but ESMO comes out to here. So how does it come out? So does it come out like attaching, or do they migrate on this part? But for the migration, here and here must be very difficult to for the proteins to move, because these areas has a very strong rigid membrane structure. So we are not puzzled. How come the ISMO migrate to the things? And this is the live imaging of acrosome reaction. And this is the right one. The red one is the ISMO. And ISMO, before acrosome reaction, ISMO is in the acrosomal areas. But after the acrosome reaction, the ISMO spread all over the entire head. And these two are the dead sperm, so we just don't see these. I'm not explaining these. But these two are the truly acrosome-reacted sperm. And after it goes spread entire acrosome, they tend to migrate to the equatorial segment of the sperm head. So what we think about this, how we interpret this data is that sperm is, before acrosome reaction, ISMO was localized on the inner outer acrosomal and the inner acrosomal membrane of acrosomal cap areas. And after acrosome reaction, while the acrosome reaction, there's a tiny hole open up here. And the GFP inside the acrosome disappears from here. And at this moment, the outer acrosomal membrane ISMO migrate out from here. And after all, acrosome-reacted sperm has the entire ISMO on the entire surface. That should be what's happening. So with the tiny hole is open up here, then the ISMO migrate probably these areas and to the entire surface. And this is the case of what happens in the fate of the ISMO at the fusion. So this sperm fuses with the eggs. So at the first initial moment of the fusion, ISMO disappears first. And then this is part is ADAM2. So ADAM2 disappears a little later. So the fusion takes place at the equatorial segment of the sperm head and with the egg. And then the ISMO disappears. And after that, the post-equatorial segment the fusion proceed to the post-equatorial segment. And after all, the sperm nucleus spread into the egg. That is what we found out. So this is the picture showing that ISMO is here in the before acrosome reaction. And then at the acrosome reaction, they spread out to the mainly equatorial segment. And the fusion takes place, and fusion takes place, these ISMO goes away many places. But in acrosomal membranes, ISMO is not, have no way to, does not migrate. If it migrates, it goes from here to here to here, but it does not happen. So it is incorporated in the egg. So in other pictures, initially the sperm has a plasma membrane and acrosomal membrane. These are two different membranes. And after the acrosomal membrane, that makes only one membrane. And after the fusion, it also makes only one membrane. Egg membrane goes to the sperm tail, to the sperm head, and this can be only one membrane. But after this first membrane happens, this part and this equatorial part fuse again. So we call this a second fusion. And if after the second fusion, this first membrane and the second membrane, we can have two membranes. So that is what happened. So by the electron microscopic observations, we see one and two membranes. So in the mammalian sperm fusion, it is not a one-step fusion event. In the fertilization in mammalian mammals is a two-step fusion. That's what we found out. And the last part of my talk is about green sperm. And we made green sperm, I showed you that. But we also made a red sperm, which is we wanted to show, we wanted to know the fate of the sperm inside the uterus. But if inside the uterus or the oviduct, sperm do acrosome react. So after the acrosome reaction, GFP is expressed, released, and the sperm cannot be seen anymore. But we want to see the acrosome reacted sperm. So we mitochondrial GFP. This is a mitochondria migrating signal having a red green fluorescent protein, and it made sperm mitochondria very red. So after the acrosome reaction, we can still say where the sperm are. And using this mouse, I asked Yuko Muro for check what is really the sperm and egg doing in vivo. And sperm is made like in humans, we have 0.1, 0.2 billion of sperm is per one ejaculation. But egg is only one. How do they decrease the numbers? What is the fate of the many sperm in the oviduct? That is a long time question. But no one really observed the sperm inside the female reproductive tract. So I asked Muro-san to observe what happened to the sperm in the oviduct. And this is the uterus, and this is the oviduct. And the oviduct and the uterus is connected by the structure called UTJ in the mouse. And this is the... This is the almost immediately after the ejaculation. Now, in the mouse, the ejaculation goes into the sperm goes into the uterus directly. So, uterus sperm does not migrate to this intertubal junction yet, not yet. But the sperm about this part is covered by sperm, and. This is, this is 15 minutes later. And 15 minutes later, sperm start to migrate into the UTJ. But we wanted to know how the sperm migrate, the manner of sperm migration, we wanted to know. But the sperm, we saw this, but they do not move at all with our naked eye. So we take time-lapse pictures. And with a time-lapse, can we make this one a little dim, the light? No person is here.